Church, this whole book is written pointing people to the cross of Calvary. And the cross of Calvary means delivered. You'll be delivered through that cross. That's the only way we're going to go. And anytime the preached word of God is coming from this pulpit, it should be maybe deliverance. And deliverance, a lot of times, well, most of the time, or just about all the time, if you get delivered for something, it means that there has to be some repentance that takes place. And repentance doesn't just mean saying, "I'm sorry, Lord." Repentance means turning from. See, when you repent something, you turn from it. And when God said he repented him, that he made man, okay? Or he was, that's what it meant, that he was almost turned from the fact that he did that. Sorry that he did it, you know. It repented him. But he never did turn his back on us, regardless of what. Anything that ever happened in those years, he never one time ever turned his back on us. As a matter of fact, about 2,000 years ago, or 2,000 years ago, he sent his son to die for us. We could have life in heaven for abundance. It could be more precious and more good than it was even in the garden when Adam and Eve first set foot in the garden, or when they were created in the garden. They were created into something that had no value at all on this earth. But yet all the riches were poured out right there in that one place. Do you realize that the Garden of Eden had no value? It was only two people. It was valuable to them and God, and that was it. As far as it being worth something for them to be able to sell and make some money off of it, it wasn't there. Nobody was there to buy it. But now, okay, we look back on it, we see what they had and what they lost. It was so valuable to them. And the main thing that they lost was their peace of mind. They lost the home security of being in their home and was taken out of it. Now, if you look at America today, you can see how in America over the years, I can remember when I was a child growing up, how that everything was right there. We had to go out and work in the field. I chopped cotton. I picked cotton. I worked in the garden with my grandma. We got what we needed to eat, but we had to go out and glean in the fields to get it. We had to go out and work. That's what God said we had to do once the garden. Amen. Once the garden. And all that take place. So we was in the obedience of the Lord, and we never been hungry. We always had something to eat. We didn't have air conditioning. The windows was always open in our house, and the curtains was flying out the windows and stuff like this, but we'd get out and play and just have us a big time, and nothing was going on, but it was not out of normal. Everybody had the same. Then all of a sudden, air conditioning come in. We can't work now without sweating. Before we had air conditioning, we'd work all day, just hardly sweating in the middle of the brow. Stand air conditioning all day, now we'll burn up all day because we better get air conditioning. Can't breathe. But you know, when you start missing those things, those luxurious things that you have, is when you start desiring to have them back. But when you start taking it all away from you, it's when you lose it. Like when a storm comes in, it knocks the power out. All these little things. And somebody said, "Well, you know, God didn't have anything to do with that." Now watch me. Everything that happens on this planet, God either does or he allows it to happen. It's not going to happen without him. He is in charge. He is in full charge. Okay? And the thing that we get ourselves into trouble a lot of times, and I'm going to get in this message here in just a moment, if we want to turn our kids over to God, we want to hang on to them. We're going to start telling God how he's supposed to watch over our kids. Well, I think God knows better. What we need to do is we need to get ourselves settled in as to who we're going to serve and who we're going to worship for and worship with. And the things that we're going to allow to happen in our lifetime. It doesn't have to happen to you because it's happening to the world. Don't believe that for one moment, because you serve a God that is a living God, and he is the God of the book of Revelation. I'm telling you this right now. Everything that he says in here will come to pass. It may not be the way that we plan it out to be, but it's going to be the way God says that it is, and that's the way it's going to be. Nothing you're going to do to stop it. Now we can get into the scripture. Are you ready? That's the prelude to the message, ain't it? Well, that was all on the Spirit. It wasn't on me. So I was just going to read the scripture. So God have your way. And unto the angel of the church of Sardis write these things, said he that had the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. You have a name that you're alive, but you're dead. How many of you know that the redeemed are gathering in? There's an in-gathering that's coming up before 12 o'clock. But they're starting to gather in. Those that are redeemed that are seeing the things that are going on out here around us, there'd been more people praying for the election this year than there probably was the last time we had an election. Because they can see that there's an urgency there, that what happens here in this election could very well have a greater impact on next year than what happens in your lives. And it will have one way or the other. Okay? If the last one did. And with the things that's trying to come against our country, we're going to hit some of these things here in this. And I'm trying not to stay too long on it. But I still have to follow the anointing. I still have to go what God says for me to do. So when we're looking down on this, now I'm going to stay with my notes. If I don't, I'll be out by John. The Sardis Church, chapter 3, started in AD 96. Now, AD 96 was a time long ago, right? Watch this. The reformation of the church began in 1500. The church was still alive in the year 1500. Now, the reformation of this church, according to the scholars and to all the history of the Bible, the reformation started in the year 1500. That's not too awful long ago. That's reforming everything and getting it back in the slot where it should be at. Okay? And Christ is in the middle of this in his prophecies back in 96 AD. So it wasn't just something that he would set up out in the future and said, this is the way that it's going to be. He knew that's the way it was going to be because he had the seven spirits of God. We're going to read those here in just a moment. Now, when you get to reading the seven spirits of God, you'll find out that those seven spirits are where Jesus puts his check marks. We call them check marks. Is that all right? He checks you out. He's checking you out with them seven spirits. It's because God is a spirit. We'll get into this, okay? Now, he had the seven spirits of God. The church began in 1500 and is still here at this very hour. The Church of Sardis is here now. Last week, we did Thyatira, and it was still here at this hour. They're all here now, except in the very beginning, Ephesus and those there. They're still here, but they're not the same church as they were, even close as they were back then. We went through Catholicism, and now we're here in this. And we're not far away from the Catholic Church in this one here either. Not very far at all. But when we look and we see the things that's happening in this with the seven spirits, you go to Isaiah chapter 11 and verse 2, and I'm going to read them to you. If you want to go there, go. If you don't, then just mark a place, and you go to them later. Isaiah chapter 11, I'm going to read verse 1 and go down maybe to verse 7. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. Here we go now. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of God. Now, why would Jesus bring in the knowledge of the fear of God? It's a spirit about him that everybody should know that we all should fear God. We should fear him. It's not something that we just, us preachers, get up on you just so that you'd want to stay off in the corner somewhere. I'm not asking nobody to do that. I'm telling you, lift up your head. That's what I'll tell you. Pray, your will be done, not mine. But when we look at this in its entirety, we see what he said, that spirit of knowledge and of the fear of God, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears. He already knows. Why? Because he's the Spirit of God. He already knows all about you. Take the say, Lord, they're done me dirty. You ain't gonna let her talk to me about that? And God says, I hear her. You let him say that about my ministry? I hear him. You see, if we get so propped up and so worried about what somebody else thinks about us, then we go hiding ourselves somewhere instead of being bold and straight to the point and saying yes is yes and no is no. You either believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, or you don't believe it at all.
Amen.
There's no such thing as in the middle of the road.
Amen.
Well, I'm going to give him a chance to prove it. Honey, he died for you. If that ain't proof enough for you, I don't know how you will get help. Because Jesus died on the cross so that you can have life and have it what? More abundantly. That's his grace. Now, when we go into the depth of this, I want to get deeper. It says, like I said before, this is where he's going to begin his checklist. John chapter 24, the Bible, I'll just quote that to you. The Bible says this, God is a spirit. Now, there's seven spirits that he's talking about. All of those spirits are one. All of those spirits are one God. Now, Jesus has those spirits, and all those spirits in Jesus makes him God in the spirit. Amen? You got it now? Okay, so Jesus is very much God. Now, he said, God is a spirit, and him that worships him must worship him in spirit and in truth. John chapter 4, 24. Say that with me. God is a spirit. He that worships him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Now, if we're worshiping him in spirit and in truth, we got to think about this in just a second. We can't just read over the top of that. If we're going to worship him in spirit, and we're talking about the seven spirits of God, where are those seven spirits at? Are they not here? Okay, so if you ain't worshiping him in your heart, you're not worshiping him at all. Those seven spirits of God are your inner person. Amen? Now, that inner person will come from here out to there, and people will know who you are.
Amen.
By the fruit that you bear. I carry the Spirit of the Lord now in me, and when I rebuke somebody, it's the Spirit of the Lord that's talking from me, and I'm rebuking in that manner. And if I'm rebuking in the name of the Lord, I'm doing it the same way, the same clothes that Jesus wore, with a crown of thorns on his head, and beat on his back until he was beaten to a pulp, and made carry that cross up Calvary's Hill. He was so humbled when he did it. When you talk to somebody, you're not pointing your finger at them, like you're cursing at them, and being God, cursing somebody for what they're doing. Because when you do that, the first thing you want to hear is, Black Lives Matter! And they keep picking at it, picking at it, and picking at it, and picking at it, and picking at it. We're going to get deep in this before it's over. You're going to see this is very much in the end time prophecies that's happening in front of you right now in your very eyes. I'll show it to you here in a few moments. It's there. It's as plain as that thing is on the end of my nose. My finger. No, you don't see what you know. Okay. But when you look and you see the things that's transpiring through all this thing, the things that's coming about, every little bit of a grouch that somebody's got against the quote-unquote holy people, a lot of them's brought it on themselves. If you smoke, you smoke. Hello? I've had them get up and walk out of this church because somebody in this church smoked one of them cigarettes that Mike smokes. Them, what do you call them, electric cigarettes? Yeah. Can you believe this? Gagging an axe while we're down. And they come tell me that they're bringing their laptop. I said, well, tell them toodaloo. Tell them toodaloo, because that's the only reason they're here, is to judge. And not can't love their brother, whom they can see, because they're doing something they do not like. Amen? That's the reason. That's the reason. That's the reason we have to preach these kind of messages. To keep everybody to where they can see that, man, I got faults too.
Absolutely.
I got faults too. I'm not perfect. I told them church one day and said, boy, they're the perfect person I've seen in my life and a perfect nuisance. And I'm serious. A perfect nuisance. Now, Jesus, now watch this. He is what God is. He has what God has in the fullness and capacity. You know what you got, what capacity means? If you got two forks, you got a half gallon capacity, right? They taught you that in school. That's capacity. Now, if you're a doctor, that's your capacity. And you don't see very many doctors. The doctors, when you see their certificate on the wall, it says they have a license to practice medicine. But they call themselves doctors because they have a license to practice medicine. Luke was the physician. Christ, the doctor. Okay, now, we're going to go on. Now, Jesus had the capacity by having the seven spirits of God to be as God. Didn't we just read it? Isaiah prophesied it. Okay. That he had the capacity to be as God. Or to be God. And when he was on this planet, he proved it. But yet he still prayed to the Father. Why? Because he was always pointing people up there. Why was he pointing us up there? Remember the prayer when he said, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. In earth is where? In heaven. Okay, so if it's God's will in heaven, it's going to be God's will down here, right? And if it wasn't God's will for it to happen up there, it's not going to happen down here. Are you praying for that? That's what I'm praying for. Your will be done. So if we're praying that, that evidently has to be the way that it is. God said it. It's settled. We don't vote on it. We don't argue on it. We don't split the church over it. We just believe it and go right on. Amen? Amen. Get him, Mike. That fly has been followed. It's followed him. He tried to run it up here on me. You want me to bring him some spray? I used to have a saying when gnats got after me like that. I ain't even used it in church. Okay. I'll get my place back here in a minute. Okay. The seven stars, seven spirits, we're not even out of the first verse. I know thy works. Okay. There's a, we'll call it an opposition of a character right here. They're opposing him. He's opposing him just a little bit. Now, the way I look at this is I'm getting close to the check marks that he's fixing to get in now. The position that they're in there is their characters are not of being like God, but being God in the fullness. Okay? That's what Jesus was. He, anything God did, he could do in the fullness because he was just like us. Amen. He had the same spirit of God. You realize how hard it would be for us to walk in the same spirit as Jesus did? First of all, we'd have to have all of them spirits, all seven of them. And I tell you what, I can't work with one of them very long without the other one trying to interfere with one another somehow or another. And I know who's putting confusion in there too. It ain't nobody but the devil.
Amen.
He's got a way of doing his work too. Don't think the devil's going to lay down just because you believe in God and let you just believe anything you want to for the Lord and just put him off out of the corner somewhere. He's going to throw some doubt in there somewhere.
Amen.
He's going to say, now, we got to do something here.
Yeah.
He said for the husbands to love the wife. But I'm not sure she loves me. Then make her love you. Make her love you. Do something.
Good.
Jesus did. Jesus said, love your wives. Therefore, it as God loved the church.
Good.
Amen?
Amen.
Christ died for the church. Okay? He wants you to live for yours. Right, right. Live for him. That's exactly what it means. It don't mean go because she does something you don't like. Knock her around. I had a guy one time, and every time his wife stepped out of line, just a little bit, he'd open the Bible and start pulling scripture out. He did that, and he just scriptured her right out the door. I'm telling you, he did. She wouldn't have anything to do with him after that. And Mavis knows who I'm talking about. Showed up in my front yard one time, wanted me to pray for him and his wife. Said, looks like we're going to split up. I said, I'm not going to pray for God to do anything there. He said, why? I said, because he's the one that's got you still together. You're just the one who messed it up. I said, he straightened you guys up. Each one of you got problems. If you wouldn't be doing this, they ended up getting divorced. In church. Loving each other. I love her, but she won't do what I tell her to do. The Bible says she's supposed to obey me. Nothing wrong. Jesus does not stand on you and make you preach to your wife. You've got lost people out there to preach to, to testify to talk to. That's what you got. You can't save the world fussing with your wife. Well, she needs to pay better attention to what I'm telling her. She will, but I don't have the door, and that's what happened. I mean, it's raining. I'm trying to get ready to go to church that Sunday morning. We got the dress pants on, no shirt on, standing in my driveway, witnessing to this guy, and I finally told him, I ain't doing it. I'll pray for him to straighten you out. And her. Because that's the only way he's going to get in this. He's not going to get in any other way. Finally, he comes to me and says, well, we're going to get her divorce. I said, I know that. He left the driveway. I know that. My kids was raised with their kids. Lena would know exactly what I'm talking about. And she knows they got the divorce. But he had the seven pastors and seven stars and all the seven churches from Ephesus to Laodicea. It represents the whole church age, from the church of Ephesus to the church of Laodicea. The whole church age. How many of you know when the church age ends, it's over with? No more churches. We're back to the temple. Okay. No more churches. The bride of Christ is called out. And those that are the dead in Christ, we call out. Then those that are alive and remain, called up at one twinkling of an eye. Now, Jesus in the clouds is called up in the moment. Okay. Thessalonians chapter 1, or no, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Okay, where it is. Now, the seven pastors, seven stars, all seven churches, Ephesus and Laodicea, represent the church age. Now here is where the check marks begin. And thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Now, checklist number one. You are dead spiritually. You say that you're alive, you're dead spiritually. Now, how could you die spiritually if you wasn't already spiritual? Get real. If you're not born of the Spirit, you're not spiritual. Amen? Okay. So, you have confessed that you are spiritual. Alright? Now, when you confess that you are dead, have spiritually, and now you're dead spiritually, that means you're floating face down in the water. We'll use the water as an example of this. How many of you know that if you see somebody floating face down in the water like this right here, chances are they're dead, placedly and spiritually? Well, the spirit can live on, even though you're floating face down and are dead. It can live on somewhere else, in hell or in heaven, from the two. two places. Now, these here that are dead spiritually, we know that they're going to end up doing good for their brother. There's some bad things that happen to them. Now, so with that Savior floating face down, they're not looking up. Worst thing is going to be happening, remember it, on earth as it is in heaven. Look up, all the things that's going on around you, God's aware of. When you go to him and you're crying and you say, Lord, I need you to fix this. He said, I've got this. Lord, I need to know, but read the end of the book. It says you win. It's already programmed out. You're a winner, regardless of what happens to this mess that's going on here that you're complaining about all the time. You are going to win. You are a winner. And then you want to say, well, even so, it didn't come quickly, Lord Jesus, take me out of this. He said, no, you may have to endure a few things. Remember, his will be done in earth and it is in heaven. If it's his will for you to endure a few things, then you just might have to worry about doing that. You know, you all know me pretty well. You know that when things come against my family, it kind of burdens me down a little bit. But when you see things happening in our family, especially with the little great granddaughter that we have, it's so humbling because it just seems like that we're always kicking against something and the devil's going up in front of us. And the Lord just has to keep telling me, I've got this. I've got this. I'm going to work a work in this. I've got this. I say, yeah, you need to show them a bunch of fools down there. See, I'm going to tell him that he needs to get them guys down there in Butler County to quit grabbing money from the state just so they can work New Children's Church. Those kind of deals. But then I have to pack up and sit down in my study in a wee hour of the morning and say, Lord, I know you've got it. I know that you've got it. And I'm going to see the end of this thing. I'll see the end of it before I have to leave here. I don't really believe that. If the Lord comes back, she's going with us anyway, so it ain't going to happen. Amen. Amen. She's still going with me. It ain't going to happen. But anyway, get off of this. I need to get it. Now, I want to read Luke chapter 21. I've got to get back into the cover some more of this. It comes after 20, right? This is the first time that I've ever applied this passage of Scripture to any one of the churches in the book of Revelation. And I think God picked the best time to do it. I know he did, but he's right, it is good. But Luke chapter 21, verse 6. I'm going to read that, and then we're going to go on down a little bit further, about 25. As for these things which ye behold the days, as for these things which ye behold, the days will come in which there shall not be left one stone from another that shall not be thrown down. Now, prior to this, we're talking about things like the children of Abraham. We talk about the stone where the builders rejected. And that's the chief cornerstone. That chief cornerstone is the last stone that's put in place. If it fits right, it'll hold that whole building together. But it's still not the foundation. The foundation is the rock that it's built upon. And once the house comes tumbling down, you can see the foundation. When we were down in Brookville fishing in the lake out there, there's foundations all over that lake. We've got a mark where we catch fish. Okay. But that house was built on those foundations, and the foundations are still there. This old foundation, this church is built on, it's so solid down there, I don't believe you can take it out of that. You'd have to get a little bit. But that's just the way that things is done. You build them to the maximum, wouldn't you can hold them the best. foundation of a house is built on the Lord, is not built on sinking sand, honey. Built on a rock. And when that house is built on a rock, you can't tear it down. You may tear the house down, but that foundation is still there. That rock will always be there for the next building to come along. It's when you start trying to destroy the foundation. The foundation this country was built on was on the cross of Calvary and a right to be able to go in and worship at the house of God and celebrate the death, burial, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ and his ascension into the heavens, knowing that one day soon we're going to go by him. We'll be there with him. That's what this country's foundation was on. Can you see the foundation right now? This country's going to be ripped apart. And when it's ripped apart, you go down and look, and you'll finally see the foundation that the United States of America was built on. Somebody said, how do you know that? Comes from the seven spirits of the Lord and read his word. It's going to come to pass. There's nothing we can do to stop it. It's in God's hands. It's his will up there and down here, remember? Now, verse 25.
Yeah.
Let me read this a little bit. I'll start with 20. And when you have seen Jerusalem packed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. Then let him which is in Judea flee to the mountains, and let him that which is in the midst of them depart out. And let not them that are in the country do. And these be the days of vengeance, that all these are written and fulfilled. We already talked earlier about how these things happened with Titus back there. In AD, I forget the year now. But woe unto them that are with child, and them that give suck in those days, for there shall be great distress in the land, wrath upon the people, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive to all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down by the Gentiles, and the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled. The time of the Gentiles is not fulfilled. Okay? The church is not fulfilled yet. It will be here quick. But the time of the Gentiles, that means the Gentiles can't be saved after that. Gentiles are still being saved. Okay? When it's done. Okay? But this thing happened with the Jews years ago when they were dispersed. I mean, they were more killed in that Holocaust when they were Alexander the Great. You know, all those men just going in and taking them over. 10 tribes. 10 tribes given to them. In that prophecy. And all of them fulfill their job they're supposed to do. They're going to come back together. They're coming back together. When they come back together, they're going to have the United States of America in their view. And we're getting to a vulnerable point right now. It's called money. It costs money to buy war. You think the Socialist Party does not know that? The Communist Party does not know that? They very well know it. It costs money. And by this time this thing's over with all the stuff that the storms is taking out right now, the fires are taking out, COVID's taking out, plus these riots are taking out. And if that fault breaks off down there, coming up through the Mississippi Valley and up through there, it's going to be a whole lot more distress in the station. Where are we going to be able to fund it? How are we going to shoot that laser from space at China, maybe the components that goes in that thing up our trigger stack? They've already got something there that'll stop that. All they've got to do is push a button here and we can fire. See, they're not total idiots. See, the only way that it will malfunction will be if it's caused malfunction from up there. It will do what God intends for it to do because he's still in charge of it. Now we're going to read. We're going to read some good stuff here. You'll probably want to shout when you read this. And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and upon the earth, distress of nations, perplexity, and the sea and the waves roaring. Now, I got some things booked out, right? There's no way I can remember them. I had to write these down too. Okay. Things that are happening, earth distress. And what it means is, it's a problem without a solution. Do you have a solution to what's going on in this world today? Only one, get back to God. But there's no solution because people didn't do it. I may have to give up something. And I've worked hard to get this. I ain't giving up nothing. I'll fight to keep it. We'll fight your way right into the grave. But when God says it's enough, it's going to be enough. It'll be enough. And I'm going to be bold here this morning and say this too. Margaret Butler, this whole church has prayed for Margaret. And she has a friend in the home where it's not a nursing home, it's a place where it's like assisted living in that. And there's a lady in there that's a Catholic, and the Catholic priest sent out a bunch of things, you know, about the abortion and stuff like that. And says it's okay for you to do it if you're a Catholic. You don't have to believe that, you know. And her son is the one who read that and ripped it up. And said he's trying to make all of us Catholics look bad. We do not believe in aborting babies. They are trying to make us look bad. I told you to save Catholics, you're going to heaven. But unsaved Baptists are going to hell. You know, it takes the Spirit of the Lord to get us out of this place. Now, with that being said, there's no solution. And the coming in of the great tribulation. No solution without the cross at all. Without the cross of Calvary, all you've got is a bigger problem. When this church here started getting away from the cross of Calvary and started depending on man's wisdom, man, it was going down the tube in a hurry, and we've been preaching for 9 years in this church, almost 9 years now, to get it back up to where it is to this day. And honey, I tell you something right now, the Feast of the Trumpets is coming up this next month, starting around the 15th of October, and you just watch what's happening in this church for that time. I look for these walls to be breaking out. Well, God's going to call them in. It's an in-gathering. He's going to call them in. That's where they dwell in the booths out of the desert after they come in and wandered around in the wilderness for 40 years. I think it's before they crossed over Jordan, too. I'm digging that out. If it is, you'll hear me yell from Brookville all the way up here. I'm going to know it's right now. It's at hand. It's fixing to happen. And I'm ready. It's almost like I can feel my feet on the lead right now. You ever had that feeling?
Oh,
your
yeah.
Feet's getting light. It's just like you can just sail on out of here.
I'm ready to go.
Yeah. Now, but the waves roaring. I wrote this down, but I want to make sure I didn't forget this. This is one of them. I'm still on the first page of my notes. I ain't went over yet, but you know this. We may be here for a while. But it's talking about the sea and the waves roaring. It's not pertaining to body of waters. But it's nations roaring and discontent, anger and rebellion. That's what this means here when it's talking about the waves roaring. How much screaming and hollering and everything have you heard blaspheming each other and blaspheming the name of God? That Fauci or Fuji or whatever his name is, he told him on earth, he said, this thing's all over with. I want to tell you, I told you so. You call me an idiot. You're a politician. I'm a scientist. And I want to tell you, I told you so. already starting to do it right now. I told you. You guys are getting out of this thing too quick. Go ahead with your bad self. Okay? I can turn my face. Only got two more pages. Okay. Anger and rebellion. Now I've got to go to Revelation for just a moment. I'm going to go back here. You can just mark this and go there later if you want to. 17 or 17 to 15. And he said to me, the waters which thou sawest, where the whore sitteth, are people and multitudes and nations and tongues. It's what he was talking about, the way of glory. In the book of Sardis. And people said, well, what they saw back then had been brought to light now. This is talking to the Jew over 17, those that are left behind, that didn't make it, that's in the tribulation period. Those things that you saw back then was a result from Luke chapter 21, verse 25. Men's hearts failing them from fear, for looking after those things are coming upon the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. On earth as it is in heaven. The powers of heaven, when they start shaking, you can look out earth. Hello? Makes sense, don't it? Everything that man fears usually is coming from up there. Ain't it? I know when I was in Vietnam, I heard, fire duck, incoming, hide. They're blasting us from up there. All you can do is hear. You can't see what direction they're coming from. When them things hit, man, they make a loud boom and then there's some bodies that are flying somewhere. You're just praying it ain't you. And then a few days later, you have to scrape up parts and put in boxes to send them home to their parents. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in clouds with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up. Lift up your heads, your redemption draweth nigh. Now, look up. Look up. When you see them begin to come to pass. I better go back to Revelation. I've got to stay one of my notes today here. They're over here, and I mean, I got to stay roughly back in the scripture. Okay. Still reading the check marks. Okay. Now, you cannot change God's will. This is another one I wrote down. I'm going to make sure that I touch on something. And when you're looking and wanting to do the will of God, sometimes you say, well, Lord, if you just make it a little bit easier, Lord, if you just give it a little bit more wisdom, instead of, Lord, your anointing will work. If you give me just a little bit more wisdom, I need to know a little bit more, Lord. I want to be great for you. Let me be great for you. If you let me be that, then I'll be satisfied. When you get satisfied, money's time for you to leave the door. I'm never satisfied. If I did, I quit studying. I ain't gonna quit studying. Now, you cannot change God's will to your will.
And that.
He proved that to Moses. Lord, I can't talk for stuttering. So he gave him Aaron to do the talking for him. He could fix him. I have speech problems, but he gave him Aaron, didn't he? No problem there. We'll fix it. But there's things that goes on with our life that God is not going to change because it's in His will. But now here's what he wants you to do, and then he may change his will, because the Apostle Paul said, remember when at the first, when I came to you, I came to you with infirmity of the flesh? And I sought the Lord three times. Remember the difference? Remember Paul said, remember at the first, when I came to you, I had infirmity of the flesh? Did that mean he no longer had the infirmity of the flesh? Or did he still have it? You know what he said? He said, whether I have it or whether I don't, it don't matter. That's what he was saying to you. And I don't think he had it, because he said, at the first when I came to you, I had infirmity in the flesh. But now it doesn't matter that I have it. I'm still going to preach. I'm still doing what God called me to do, regardless of what you think about me. If you're a preacher, why are you wearing them glasses for? I need them. I put my eyes out with welders and stuff. That's what I need them for. And it's God's will for me to wear glasses, but it didn't heal them. So I keep fighting glasses, putting my own distracting people when I do it, but it doesn't matter. You know, I'm still going to preach His word, and I'm still going to be His. Okay? Now, you cannot change God's will to your will. But you can change yourself to do what? His will. Woo! Say that. Woo! You can't change yourself to do God's will. Boy, that's hard to do, ain't it? The hardest thing you ever done in your life is surrender to something like that. It ain't hard to do it once you surrender, but it's hard to surrender. Because the first thing you're going to say is, Lord, it'll take me out of my comfort zone. Okay. Now, remember what we said. You get the strength of you. When you're under this watchful sin, I gotta get back to verse 2. I ain't even got to the second verse yet. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found thy works perfect before God. Now, watchful, see the real condition, and gather strength from the cross. For the debt was paid in full. It cost you nothing to go there. It will not cost you to go back. That is the message for that passage of Scripture. When you got saved, it didn't cost you anything to go to the cross for your salvation. You wander away from the cross, it didn't cost you nothing to go back either. Except maybe your life. You see, when you go to the cross and you repent, the only thing that will lead you away from the cross is I can't live it. I can't live it no way. And you can't without faith. There's no way. There's only one way you can live it, and that's by faith. Now, you'll drown if you're just, I'm going to use treading water here. You'll drown just sitting there treading water. You're like Peter in the middle of the night when he saw Jesus coming walking on the water. He said, Lord, if it be you, bid me come to you. Well, he put Jesus in the spot. Lord, if it be you, what was Jesus going to say? My name ain't got me stand above. No, he said, just bid me come. He said, if it's you, bid me come. He said, well, come. Because it's me. So Peter gets out of the boat, starts walking. He looks and sees all the men around him. He's out here, the waves are smacking up on him. He's walking on it. Now, what happened? I'm out here all by myself. I was in a dry boat now, and all of a sudden he starts to sing. And he said, save me. Save me. You know, I'm going to give you this and promise you that this is true. There have been many times that I've never asked Him to save my soul for time. But I've asked Him to save me from the mess that I'm in. Yeah. You ever been there? Save me from this mess. He didn't say one time to me, I didn't put you there, I ain't going to pull you out. Yeah. Save me from this mess. I did it. Now, take hold on the cross with a virus and a hope. Here's another checklist. Take hold of this cross. It's for the fire coming down. The fire of the checklist. Go to Matthew chapter 3. I'll probably close here with this being a checklist here, honey. Go to the last page. I don't know. May finish them up tonight. Okay. Matthew chapter 3. Verse 9, and think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham for our father. For I say unto you, that God is able of these stones to raise their children of Abraham. Joshua put 9 stones in the river Jordan. John was baptizing, I believe, at that very spot. And now have the axe and laid at the root of the trees. Therefore every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water and repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost, comma, and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Then came Jesus from Galilee to Jordan, John to baptize him, but John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Jesus answering said unto him, suffer it to be so now, for thus it become us to fulfill all righteousness. Fulfill all righteousness. Now, here we go. Take hold of the cross, because the cross is where the fire comes down. Okay, he will thoroughly purge his floor, separate the chaff from the garner. And what's he going to do with the chaff? Burn it. Okay, done. Okay, he's going to do away with it, burn it. Tear it up. He's not going to cool it either. And when this is all done, if the works are not perfect, then dead faith cannot produce good works. And if the works are not perfect, dead faith cannot produce good works. Anytime that we keep returning to God with the same problem, God calls that dead faith. Listen to me now. Because if our faith is what it needs to be, we just ask him like he told Daniel. He said, I heard you the first time, dude. You're fasting for 21 days trying to get me to do something. I sent the angel, and he held him up, you know, all this stuff. I'm just paraphrasing from it a little bit, but that's what he was telling Daniel. And you're going to fast for 30 days? I heard you. I heard what you were saying. It will work when I'm ready for it to work. I knew I had to send Michael. I know I had to send the angel down there to put that devil. I know they had to do that. And I know that it was going to take a little while to do it, but I wanted him to get a good whooping while he was there. I'm paraphrasing. That's the only reason it would take God 21 days, because he could put his finger on his head and held him in one place and let that angel surround him. But he didn't. 21 days he held up Daniel's blessings. Why? It was his will in heaven. He's not going to do it when we snap our finger. God's not a genie in a box. God's an all-seeing God. He knows it all. You don't slip anything on him. He knows about it. Now, verse 3. Remember. You got to remember how you received your salvation, and just remember that that's you. I was going to insert some more stuff that I don't remember. The same way that you received your salvation, the same way that you believe everything. I'm going to show you how that happens. How do you feel like getting up? want you to pay attention to Mike here just a moment. Just stand right here. You don't have to get that iron hunger down a little. Just stand right by it. All right. Did you ask Christ to come into your life? You believe that you're saved? You believe that all your heart? Okay. Now, when he walks away from you, what's happening to him? He's going to walk away from you by faith that he's saved. Now, watch what happens when he gets it. Turns this way to walk back to the sea. You didn't get nothing. That preacher done lied to you. You ain't saved. What the Word of God say? Okay. He said he was saved. Absolutely, he is saved. He knows he's saved. Beyond a doubt, he's saved. Okay. Now, if it's the same faith that we're saved by, faith in the cross, faith in what Jesus did, that saves our soul, how come we have such little faith when it comes to him taking care of our needs? Hello? And you know, one of the things that's one of the biggest stumbling blocks you'll have in being able to get your faith to work for you is the love you have for your brother. That will be one of the biggest stumbling blocks. Thanks for being a stand-in. You know, I'm not a whiz kid. Ninth grade education, you can't call that a whiz kid, I'll tell you that right now. I came to the school of hard knocks. I had to wear some whoopings, or whippings, how you want to say it. I had to wear some whippings from God. Okay, judgment will come to service, or it will not hear due to spiritual deafness and blindness. They can't see nor hear. And I'm going to close with that for today. May come back tonight for some more of that. I don't know yet. It's up to God. But I'll tell you this. Did you learn anything about the Church of Sardis?